Some people have naturally curly hair, some people have naturally straight hair, and many of us do hair treatments to change between one and the other as we like. In this video, we will learn about how hair curliness versus hair straightness relates to the oxidation of thiols and the reduction of disulfides as a key reaction that occurs to convert between the two styles. In order to understand this, the first thing we need to do is review the thiol functional group and also introduce the so-called disulfide group. These two groups are going to be key to understanding the chemistry of curly hair versus straight hair. A thiol group, as we learned in an earlier module, refers to a carbon or carbons, I'll highlight that as an R group, that is directly connected to an SH group. We refer to that as the thiol functional group. An additional functional group, one that we haven't covered thus far in our standard list of functional groups, refers to a structure where we have a sulfur-sulfur bond. We refer to this sulfur-sulfur bond that we are seeing here, where the R groups are carbon or carbons that are connected there, as a disulfide. Di referring to two, and the sulf referring to the fact that these are two sulfur atoms that are connected together. The relationship between these two structures is that the thiol is reduced relative to the disulfide. So in other words, to go from one to the other would require oxidation. We refer to this as an oxidation process or an oxidation reaction because we're increasing the number of bonds between carbon and sulfur and going from reactant to product here. And technically, to balance out this equation, we would really need two thiol molecules coming together to have the adequate number of atoms to form this disulfide, where half of the disulfide is from one of the thiol molecules and the other half is from the other. Now, if we wanted to go in the other direction, we would refer to that as a reduction process because we're reducing the number of bonds between carbon and the electronegative sulfur atom. So we'd refer to that as reduction. This reaction is fully reversible, and this reaction is at the heart of curly hair versus straight hair. You see, the thiol functional group is found within one of the 20 amino acids that are the building blocks of proteins. Specifically, cysteine, one of the 20 amino acids, and I'll abbreviate amino acid as AA, has a thiol group. Proteins are abundant in human hair, and one of the amino acid building blocks of those proteins that are found in human hair is the cysteine residue. What occurs with hair is that if the cysteine residues are found in this traditional natural thiol group, then the hair will be relatively straight. On the other hand, due to genetic factors or due to things like treatment with a perm, instead an oxidation reaction will occur and the cysteine residues will be found predominantly in their oxidized state, which refers to the disulfide. So the disulfide is what results from two cysteines linking together. And I'll abbreviate cysteine as CYS, that is the three-letter abbreviation for that amino acid. In a much later video, we will get into the basics of how amino acids link together to form proteins. But for now, we'll recognize just that cysteine is one of the 20 amino acids that are the building blocks of proteins, and that we get this disulfide bridge, or these two sulfur atoms connected together, from two cysteines linking together. And that can occur either through your natural biology, if you have naturally curly hair, or through a chemical treatment process where when you go to the hairstylist, if you have straight hair, that straight hair can be treated with an oxidizing agent by the hairstylist to oxidize those thiol residues into these disulfide bonds where different cysteine residues within the protein joins together to form this disulfide, which results in what we would generally describe as curly hair. Versus on the other side, the thiol group that has not been oxidized results in what we would generally describe as straight hair. So we can convert between these two as desired. In the case of someone that has a disulfide-rich hair, which is curly, if they want to go towards straight hair, then they treat the disulfide with a reducing agent to convert it into the thiol form. Now let's try our hand at applying this basic information that we just looked at towards some applied problems like the type that you would encounter on assessments in the class. We are asked here to predict the major organic product of each reaction shown below. When we say the major organic product, that is what is the final result of mixing together, in this case, two thiol molecules and treating it with O. O refers to an oxidizing agent. It's our generic way of pointing out that we are going to be oxidizing the molecule. So O here in brackets refers to our generic way of treating with an oxidizing agent. We saw this terminology also when we were oxidizing alcohol molecules. And now we'll similarly apply that designation of O in brackets to denote oxidation of our thiol molecule. Recognize that oxidation of thiols yields disulfides as our general rule. That is what we need to apply here. So this is our very general rule that thiols, if we recognize our functional group there, then that's the key to problem solving chemical reactions, is by focusing on the functional group and thinking about what types of reactions those functional groups undergo. Thiol functional group's characteristic reaction is that thiols are oxidized to disulfides. And therefore, based on that fundamental general information, we can apply that toward this problem. So we have two thiols, oxidizing it to a disulfide. We recognize that the key core of a disulfide is that the disulfide absolutely has to have a sulfur-sulfur bond. So I'm going to plug that in, recognizing that that's the functional group that has to be present in the product. And then to determine what's connected to each of those sulfur atoms, what we have to remember is that this oxidation reaction will result in the carbon chains still being connected to the sulfur, but we form a link between two sulfurs. Sulfur here from one of the two molecules that are reacting, and then the other sulfur atom connected to that. So let's fill in. In each case, there should be a tert-butyl group attached. An isobutyl group attached, my bad, four carbons in total. And it's the next to the last carbon of the chain here where we have that methyl branch coming off. So we have this as our isobutyl group. And then same on the other side, isobutyl group here. I could have drawn my zigzag line coming down from the sulfur like I did. I could have also shown it going up from the sulfur. It doesn't matter which, as long as you have four carbons in total over here and it's branched like this, where the next to the last carbon of the chain, there is a methyl group going on. And the reason it doesn't matter whether you orient the line going up or down is because since these are carbon-carbon single bonds, they can freely rotate anyway. So whatever position we draw it in is ultimately random, because in reality, there's constant rotation around the bonds to put that at any position within the range of rotation. So in general, as we work through these types of problems, what you need to keep central in your mind is that when we're going through these problems, thiols are always going to be oxidized to disulfide. So if you see a thiol reactant and it's being treated with an oxidizing agent, what you need to start thinking about then more specifically is what disulfide is it going to relate to and result in. And that's going to correspond to the disulfide that would have the R group from the starting thiol molecule. We can also work the reverse reaction direction, where we will start with a disulfide molecule. We recognize this as our disulfide functional group, because as the sulfur-sulfur bond, and we treat it with a reducing agent. There's no fancy abbreviation here for reducing agent, so we just write that out as reducing agent. What reducing agents will do to disulfides, as our general rule that we can fill in here, is that reducing agents, or I'll call them red agents, will convert disulfides into thiols. So we need to think more specifically now about what thiol or thiols the reducing agent will convert our starting material into here. So what is the thiol product going to be? The way that we work that is we envision that the reducing agent is going to break this sulfur-sulfur bond and replace with a bond to hydrogen here and a bond to hydrogen here. And so dissecting what's going on here on the left side, we would have a sulfur bonded to a 3-carbon chain, 1-carbon, 2-carbon, 3-carbons. On the other side, the right-hand side of this business, we would have a 2-carbon chain, 1, 2, directly connected to the sulfur atom. And therefore, our final product here will correspond to one of our products being a thiol with 3 carbons. That would correspond to breaking the group apart here across the sulfur and looking at what's on the left of that. And we have the 3 carbons there in the sulfur. So 1, 2, 3, color-coded in yellow like it is over here. And then on the other side, we've broken that bond and we will have a 2-carbon chain here and here with a sulfur and that new hydrogen bonded to it so that it fills the octet. So I can fill that as HS and then our 2-carbon chain here and here. And I'll highlight that as well to make the highlighting there match up in blue with what we saw over here. So the bottom line to keep in mind here to solve any problem that deals with disulfides is you treat a disulfide with a reducing agent, and the outcome of that is going to be a thiol product or thiol products. And particularly in the case where this is an asymmetrical disulfide, where like over here we have a 3-carbon chain, here we have a 2-carbon chain, you'll end up with 2 different products. If the molecule is symmetrical, like 3 carbons on the left, 3 carbons on the right, you would end up with 2 units of a single product, like 2 units of a 3-carbon thiol, for example. So with all this information in hand, you should now be comfortable with taking thiols and oxidizing them to form disulfides, or going in the reverse direction, treating a disulfide with a reducing agent to give a thiol product. This chemistry is very industrially important, including in the manufacture of a variety of hair treatment agents.